In this video, I'll explain how two different pressures, hydrostatic and osmotic pressure, drive fluid out of and back into your blood vessels. These pressures might seem a bit unimportant at first, but they'll help us explain some interesting cases of edema or tissue swelling. So, enough talking, let's do it. Welcome to Physio Flip. Here we have a tissue like muscle or nervous tissue, which is being supplied with blood by this network of capillaries. Capillaries, with their thin walls, pores, and gaps, are specially designed to allow for the exchange of nutrients, gases, wastes, and fluid between the blood and the tissues. They're the place in the cardiovascular system where we can get stuff into the blood and get stuff out of the blood. For example, as blood flows into the capillary on the arterial end, you'll notice that some fluid is filtered out of the blood vessel. However, we normally don't want that fluid to stay in the interstitial space, as this could lead to fluid collecting in the tissues, causing swelling. Many of you have probably experienced this before. If you've ever stayed standing for too long, you might have noticed that your ankles, which looked normal before, started to swell up or experience what's called edema. This is caused by fluid staying outside the blood vessel within the interstitial space, causing the tissue to swell. To prevent this swelling from happening, much of the fluid that was filtered out is normally reabsorbed back into the capillary at the venule end. So, fluid out and fluid back in. But why was fluid forced out in the first place, and how does it get reabsorbed? Well, let's zoom in first on the fluid being filtered out to see what's going on. The pressure that drives fluid movement out of the blood is called hydrostatic pressure. Instead of some fancy definition of what hydrostatic pressure is, I'm just gonna show you what it is using an example that some of you might be able to try out at home. Here I have a straw, like what you might use to drink. What I'm gonna do is put my finger on this end of the straw, preventing fluid from leaving. Then I'm gonna fill up the straw with water. If I were to take this straw and poke a hole in it over here, what do you think would happen? You might have guessed it. Water is gonna begin to leak out. Why is that though? Well, all the water in the straw is being pulled down by gravity, which then applies pressure to the water down here by my finger. This pressure is termed hydrostatic pressure and generates an outward pressure that will drive fluid out of the straw. You might be thinking, all right, dude, we don't care about the straw. What is with this straw? Well, what I just showed you is basically the same thing that happens in your capillaries. Your cardiovascular system is basically just a long straw with holes in the capillaries. And in our capillaries, due to the amount of fluid in our cardiovascular system and the hydrostatic pressure in the arterial end of the capillaries, fluid is forced out through microscopic pores and channels in the capillary walls. But if hydrostatic pressure were all we had, fluid would collect in the tissues and we'd experience edema or swelling just about all the time. Okay, so time for our second key term, osmotic pressure. Osmotic pressure is based on one key fact. By osmosis, water always flows towards regions in the body that have a higher osmolarity, or a higher concentration of solute particles. For example, let's say we have some water surrounding a vessel shown here in yellow. This vessel has some pores or small holes, which allow certain particles to cross and prevent others from crossing. Inside this vessel, I'll put a high concentration of some particle, shown here in orange. Notice that this particle's concentration is much higher on the inside of the vessel compared to the outside. But if this particle is relatively large, maybe like a protein molecule, and cannot leave this vessel through the small pores, that means that the concentration of these large protein molecules is going to remain high inside the vessel and remain low on the outside of the vessel. But by osmosis, since water always flows towards regions with a higher concentration of particles, what do you think water is going to do in this case? Yep. In this case, water is going to be reabsorbed back into the vessel towards the higher concentration of particles. This situation, again, is almost exactly what is happening in your capillaries. In your blood, you'll find a higher concentration of proteins like the serum protein albumin compared to outside the blood vessels in the interstitial space. Because of this higher concentration of proteins in your blood, fluid tends to be reabsorbed back into the blood, driven by osmosis and by osmotic pressure. So, hydrostatic pressure tends to drive fluid out of your blood, osmotic pressure tends to drive it back in. Quick side note, this osmotic pressure, caused by large molecules like proteins, is called colloid osmotic pressure, or oncotic pressure. So as I mentioned osmotic pressure in this video, I'm really talking specifically about what's called colloid osmotic pressure, just FYI. Also, we do have other solutes in our blood besides proteins, like ions, like sodium and chloride. However, these do not contribute to the osmotic pressure or the reabsorption of fluid. If you're curious as to why, you can check out the comments below. Zooming back out, let's put it all together to see how hydrostatic pressure and osmotic pressure filter and reabsorb fluid at the capillaries. At the arterial end of the capillary, the hydrostatic pressure is higher than the osmotic pressure. This causes fluid to be forced out into the interstitial space. But as hydrostatic pressure decreases as we move through the capillary, the osmotic pressure eventually becomes equal to and even greater than the hydrostatic pressure, causing nearly all of the filtered fluid to be reabsorbed back into the capillary at the venule end of the capillary. You might notice that there's still a small fraction of fluid sitting in the tissues though. Not all of it is reabsorbed back by osmotic pressure. That's where our final player comes in, the lymphatic system. Vessels of the lymphatic system will help reabsorb the remaining small fraction of filtered fluid that wasn't reabsorbed by osmotic pressure, helping us to prevent swelling or edema. And there you have it. In the next videos, we'll review a few cases where fluid does collect within the tissue caused by abnormal changes in hydrostatic pressure or osmotic pressure. For example, I'll explain in detail why our ankles swell up when we sit or stand for too long.